Well, good morning. Welcome to Creek's End today. It's good to see you. We're on a series now called Masterpiece. And it's going to be 8 weeks long. It's going to take us to the end of June. Can you believe that? But you're not going to want to miss any of this. We're looking at some paintings that are going to help us deal with some topics that we're going to face in our life and what the Bible has to say about those topics. And today we're going to look at a special piece called The Shipwreck of the Minotaur. Now, I'm sure that if I let you, you could come up here and tell a story of a tough time that you've had in your life, a difficulty. We've all had them, and we face them all the time. And I was going to share one of mine, but I found something that happened to another guy that I could not beat. I could not up this guy. Of something that happened to him in one single day. This guy's name is Brian Heiss of Provo, Utah. And he recently experienced more difficulty than any human being should have to face on a single day. I thought I'd share it with you. The first thing that happened on this day was a water pipe broke in the upstairs apartment above his, which flooded his apartment. And the manager asked him to go and rent a wet dry vacuum. And when he walked outside to do that, he discovered he had a flat tire. So he changed the flat tire, but then he decided he wanted to call a friend to help him, you know, get a water vacuum, and he noticed that his cell phone was totally dead. So he walked back inside because he still had a landline, and he tried to call his friend, but he was standing in water, and the shock from the telephone was, he ripped the phone basically off the wall. after he tried to call his friend, he was going to go back outside, but the water had now swollen the front door. He couldn't open it, so somebody had to kick it open from the outside. And then, while all this was going on, someone stole Brian's car. He had just changed the flat. I guess they were waiting on him. But it was almost out of gas, so they found it a few blocks away. But he had to push it to a gas station to gas it up. Well, that evening, Heiss attended a military ceremony at BYU, and he injured himself severely because he somehow sat down on his own bayonet, which had been tossed in the front seat of his car. Ouch. Doctors were able to stitch up his wounds, but no one was able to resuscitate Brian's four canaries crushed to death when wet seating plaster fell from his apartment ceiling while he was gone. When he got home, he slipped on the wet carpet and injured his tailbone. Mr. High said he began to wonder if God wanted me dead but kept missing. All in one day. That's a tough day, isn't it? I don't think I can beat that. I've had some tough stuff happen to me, and I know you have too, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Tough stuff. But here's the deal. Jesus said in John 16, you're going to have trouble. You're going to have problems. You're going to have shipwrecks. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And that's great news for us today. And I've chosen this painting by Joseph Mallard William Turner. That was his name. And The Shipwreck of the Minotaur. As kind of, because it reminds me of a storm that we're going to be talking about in just a moment. Turner was born in 1775, just as America was beginning to move toward independence. And he was a watercolorist. He was a great painter. In his teenage years, he started showing promise. He was a printmaker. And was fascinated with natural catastrophes. And if you Google Turner in some of the paintings, you're going to see a lot of ships and a lot of sea, but he also liked fires and painting those natural disasters that would happen with storms and fog and things like that and clouds. And he painted many ships and shipwrecks. This particular painting of the Minotaur, it was a British warship. And in 1810, it was sailing on the coast of the Netherlands with another warship, British warship, and it wrecked off the coast. When you read the history about it, it was kind of a huge story because the Netherlands, the people of the Netherlands knew it had happened, and 370 people died because they refused to go out and rescue them. And there was a big thing between the British government and the Dutch government at that time. And so I guess that's what inspired Turner to paint this painting. But he was so fascinated by this. And there's a story that says that he actually had himself tied to the mast of a ship so that he could experience the turbulence. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, and I'm certainly not smart, is it? But at any rate, he was a great painter, probably the best painter to ever come out of Britain. And so many of his works are about this. Now, like I said, this reminds me of another shipwreck that happened in the Bible, and it's in Acts chapter 27, if you want to turn there, in the New Testament. Of course, I'm going to put the verses up on the screen. If you don't have a Bible, but what happens is that Paul, the Apostle Paul, has been arrested, and they are taking him to Rome to stand trial before the Caesar. And so to get there, they have to get there by boat. And Paul is kind of going through a personal storm with all that, but then literally is going to go through a literal storm, because Paul actually told the guys that God said, don't sail yet. Now, I know that God wanted Paul in front of the Caesar for sure, but the timing was not right for some reason. And Paul said, guys, you don't want to sail yet because we're going to run into a storm. But they wouldn't listen to him. And so ultimately, and we don't have time to read the whole story, but ultimately the ship did get into a storm and there was a shipwreck. And you can read all about that in the book of Acts. But here's what we're going to learn through this whole experience today. That when the storms of life threaten to wreck our boat, God says, stay with the ship. Stay with the ship. When you're going through a storm, stay with the ship. Now, we're not talking like being a captain who goes down with the ship. We're talking about staying with the ship. If you know anything about the New Testament boat experiences of Jesus, you should know this. You are safer in the boat with Jesus than you are outside of the boat without him. And that's one of the points that Paul's going to make today in this passage in Acts, is that when the storms of life threaten to wreck your boat, threaten to wreck your marriage, threaten to wreck your relationship, threaten to wreck your finances, threaten to wreck your emotions, threaten to wreck your career, God says, stay with the ship. Ride it out, because you're in better shape with him on the boat than off the boat without him. So we're going to be in Acts 27. And as we read this, I want to point out a few things that I think are very important for us to learn when we're going through difficulties. And I know some of you at this very moment are going through a difficulty. Financially, emotionally, health-wise, maybe career-wise, maybe your relationship-wise, your marriage, going through some difficulties. And let me tell you something, if you're not, usually here's where we are. We're either just coming out of one, we're in the middle of one, or we're heading for one. Right? That's life, right? So how do we react to that? How do we respond to that? And that's what I want to show you through this painting and through the scriptures today. We're going to start reading verse 7. Verse 7, Acts 27, verse 7. We had several days of slow sailing, and after great difficulty, we finally neared Cnidus. But the wind was against us, so we sailed across to Crete, and along the sheltered coast of the island, past the Cape of Salmone. We struggled along the coast with great difficulty and finally arrived at Fair Havens near the town of Lasea. We had lost a lot of time, and the weather was becoming dangerous for sea travel because it was so late in the fall, and Paul spoke to the ship's officers about it. Here's what Paul said, "Men, I believe there is trouble ahead if we go on. Shipwreck, loss of cargo, and danger to our lives as well. But the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain and the owner than they did to Paul." Verse 12, "And since Fair Havens was an exposed harbor, a poor place to spend the winter, most of the crew wanted to go on to Phoenix." That's not Arizona, okay? They wanted to go to Phoenix, further up the coast of Crete, and spend the winter there. Phoenix was a good harbor with only a southwest and northwest exposure. So when a light wind began blowing, in verse 13, from the south, the sailors thought they could make it. So they pulled up anchor and sailed close to the shore of Crete. Now, let me just stop here and give you something to think about. Whenever there is a storm in your life, whenever there is a difficulty in your life, here's what you need to think about first. There just might be a reason for the storm. There might be a reason for the storm, and you have to ask the question, what caused this? Now, basically, there are four different causes of storms that come into our life, and you might want to write these down. The first one is me. Not for your storm, for my storm. I cause a lot of the storms in my life. You cause a lot of the storms in your own life because of the decisions that you make, the patience that you refuse to have. You are probably the major cause of most of the storms that you go through, just simply because of the decisions you make and the choices that you make. But secondly, it could be others, and we don't have a whole lot of control over that. There could be others that come into our life or into our situation, and that's why we're going through the difficulty, because they caused it. But then there's something else you need to think about. Third is that Satan can cause difficulty. Now, don't underestimate the enemy. Now, I know you may think, do you really believe in Satan? I will just tell you this. Jesus believed in Satan, a real literal Satan, and that's a whole other sermon. But he can bring difficulty into our lives. He brought it into Jesus' life. But then four, God can also allow or bring difficulty into our lives. And remember what this whole series is about. It's about him making us a masterpiece. And many times he will allow storms to come into our life in order to build character. He's just working on the brushstrokes, trying to make something beautiful out of our lives, a masterpiece. So those are the four causes of problems that come into our lives. And we have to stop and go, okay, what's the reason I'm going through this storm? See, when these guys decided to sail into the Mediterranean Sea and Paul said, don't do it or we're going to go into a storm, they made three very common mistakes. And they're mistakes that you and I tend to make when we have difficulties in our lives. Number one, we listen to bad advice. If you look at verse 11 again, it says, but the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain and the owner than they did to Paul. See, God had already said not to go. Paul had already warned them. But because the expert, the ship captain, said it was okay, you know, they did it. What you're going to find is there are a lot of experts in the world. They're on every talk show. But here's the advice I would give you today. If God says to do this, and an expert says to do this, you might want to lean toward what God says. I'm just saying, okay? God's the expert. Don't listen to the experts. So we listen to bad advice. Secondly, we follow the crowd. Look at verse 12 again. Most of the crew wanted to go on to Phoenix, farther up the coast of Crete, and spend the winter there. Now, there were 276 people on this boat. The vote was 273-3 to sail. The majority won. Let me tell you something. The majority is often wrong. You remember in the Old Testament when the children of Israel had left Egypt and they were trying to go to the Promised Land and all these difficulties start happening, you know, they get hungry, they get thirsty. What do they want to do? You remember? They want to go back to Egypt. And most of them wanted to go back to Egypt. Listen, the majority is often wrong. Don't follow the crowd. And don't base your morality on peer pressure. Everybody's doing it. You know, teenagers, you need to hear this. Adults, we need to hear it too. Just because everybody's doing it doesn't mean that we need to do it too. Number three, we rely on circumstances. Look at verse 13. It says, when a light wind began blowing from the south, the sailors thought they could make it, so they pulled up the anchor and sailed close to the shore of Crete. They thought it was a nice day for sailing. Paul said, don't do it. We're heading into a storm. But they went anyway, and as you read later on, they eventually shipwrecked. See, we have this tendency to rely on circumstances, and you know, the stars have lined up, and the things have all fallen into place. Listen, you should not go through every open door you see. You should not date everybody who asks you out on a date. You shouldn't take advantage of every opportunity just because it looks good. You see, it looked okay for them to sail out to the ocean. The wind was calm. It looked great. But God had already said no, and they headed right for a storm. See, they thought their plan would work. They thought they could control the outcome. And a lot of people go foolishly right into a storm because they've been listening to the wrong people and doing the wrong things. Well, let's look at verse 14. Here's what happened. They thought it was great, so they started sailing. And in verse 14, but the weather changed abruptly, and a wind of typhoon strength, called the Northeaster, caught the ship and blew it out to sea. They couldn't turn the ship into the wind, so they gave up and let it run before the gale. We sailed, verse 16, we sailed along the sheltered side of a small island named Cauda, where with great difficulty we hoisted aboard the lifeboat being towed behind us. So they were towing a lifeboat behind them, and they got it on the ship so they couldn't lose it. In verse 17, then the sailors bound ropes around the hull of the ship to strengthen it. They were afraid of being driven across the sandbars of Sirtis off the African coast. So they lowered the sea anchor to slow the ship and were driven before the wind. Now look what happens. The next day, as gale force winds continued to batter the ship, the crew began throwing the cargo overboard. And the following day, they even took some of the ship's gear and threw it overboard. And the terrible storm raged for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars until at last all hope was gone. I mean, I look at this and go, how, you know, we survived Ike, didn't we? But we were on land. Can you imagine that in the water, in a boat made of wood? It says they tied the ropes around the hull to try to keep it together. I mean, I just can't imagine what they were going through, what they were thinking, how scared they were. But how do you react? How do you respond when you're going through something like this? How do you react? You're going to have problems. You're going to have hurt. How do you respond? Here's what the Bible says. There is a right response to the storm. To every difficulty we have in life, there is a right response. And when we go through those situations in life and those difficulties, what happens to you is not nearly as important as what happens inside of you. Did you hear what I just said? When you're going through difficulties, what happens to you is not nearly important as what happens inside of you. Those circumstances, those storms, they're only temporary. They're not what you're going to take into eternity. What you take into eternity with you is your character. And your response and how you reacted in the circumstances, whether you became bitter or whether you became better. So how do you respond in difficult situations like this? Well, in this passage, I can tell you this. There's three things you shouldn't do. And you might want to write these down. First of all, don't drift. Don't drift. Verse 15, it says, the ship was being caught by the storm and could not head into the wind. Look at this. So we gave way to it and were driven along. They just let go. And this ship was taking prisoners to Rome. And it's in the middle of the Mediterranean Ocean. They haven't seen the sun for 14 days, total darkness. They have no idea where the stars are. They can't get their bearings. And driven along means that they were just, they had no destination. They started drifting. And that, it's what you and I tend to do when the difficulties of life hit us hard. We tend to say, you know what? Let me just let go. It's not worth it. It's not working. I'm not even going to try. I just let go. They have no goal, no objective, no purpose, no ambition. I mean, Today we don't call it drifting. You know what we call it today? Coasting. We coast. We just try to get through. You know what the problem with coasting is? You cannot coast uphill. You will always coast downhill. And that's where that reaction is going to take you. If you just say, I'm just going to give up and whatever happens, happens. And you know, we'll just, whatever. You know, if you're coasting, you're going in the wrong direction. Don't drift. Secondly, don't discard. In verse 18, it says, the next day the storm was blowing us so hard that the men threw out some of the cargo. They had been battered by the winds and waves back and forth, and they start throwing things overboard to lighten the ship. And the first thing they threw over was cargo. The second day they threw over the fish, the gear, the tackle. And then, you know, they threatened to even throw some of the prisoners on board when you read the rest of the story. I mean, they just kept discarding things and abandoning things that they really needed for the journey. And when we start going through these difficult times, this is such a common reaction. We start abandoning our values. And we start even abandoning the relationship or the problem. And we start trying to discard things that we know we're going to need for the journey. We just throw in the towel. I mean, people give up on their marriage. People give up on their dreams, their career. I'm not going to try to go to college. I'm not going to try to make this marriage work. I'm not going to try to make this financial decision right now. And we abandon and discard the things that we really need for the journey. So don't discard. And then three, don't despair. In verse 20, it says, for many days we could not see the sun or the stars, and the wind kept on blowing very hard. We finally gave up all hope of being saved. 14 days in total darkness, not knowing where they're going. Beat up, tossed back and forth. They've given up their cargo, their tackle, their food, and finally they give up hope. And hope's the last thing to go, isn't it? But they've forgotten one thing. Even in a storm, God is in control. And it's a whole lot better to stay in the ship with Him. He'll help you through it. And for whatever reason, God may be just working His magic, His paintbrush, trying to make you something beautiful. So the right response to difficulty is stay with the ship. Well, look at verse 30 and how this ends. And this is very interesting. Then the sailors tried to abandon the ship. Remember that lifeboat that they put in the boat? Well, they lowered the lifeboat as though they were going to put out anchors from the front of the ship. But Paul said to the commanding officer and the soldiers, "You will all die unless the sailors stay aboard." Verse 32, So the soldiers cut the ropes to the lifeboat and let it drift away. What? That's your only means of rescue? You cut the lifeboat and let it go? Yeah. And the reason they cut the lifeboats was to force everyone to stay on the ship. Now let me ask you a question. Have you done that in your marriage? Have you cut the lifeboat so there's no way to get off the ship? Have you said divorce is not an option for us? We're going to make this thing work. We're going to close the escape hatch. We're going to lock the door and throw away the key. And that's what Paul's trying to get you to see here. If you don't throw away the key, you'll never develop the character to stay on the ship. You'll just get on another ship, the next storm that comes along. We'll leave that one too. God says, stay with the ship. Charles Kettering said something interesting. He said, no one would have ever crossed the ocean if they could have gotten out of the boat every time a storm came. America would not be discovered if every time a storm came, a sailor got off the boat. God says, stay with the ship. And it's always easier to abandon the ship, isn't it? It's always easier, but God says, I want to develop character in you. I want to change situations. I want to change personalities. I want to make something beautiful of your life. Stay with the ship, because I'll go through it with you. Don't throw out the values you know are right and important. Don't abandon the things you know that you're going to need. The band's going to come and sing a song I want you to hear. But before they do, I want you to take one last look at this picture. You know, we see copies of this. If you ever want to see the real thing, you'll have to go to Lisbon, Portugal, because that's the only place that it's in, actually in a museum there. But Turner, as he got older, became more eccentric. And he didn't have a whole lot of friends. His father was probably his closest friend. His father lived with him for 30 years. And when his father died, it had a very profound effect on his life. He went into bouts of depression, and he would disappear for days at a time. And near the end of his life, he died in the house of his mistress, weary and tired of all the difficulties that his life had brought him. Turner was a famous and brilliant painter, but he failed miserably at life because he didn't know how to handle the storms. What about you? You going through something right now that's very difficult? A storm is threatening to wreck your boat? Probably a reason for it, but there's definitely a response, a right response. And how you respond determines, your future. Don't abandon your values. Don't just drift along, give up. And don't lose hope. God is still in control of the boat. And if you will stay with the ship, God will do something beautiful. So if you're a Christ follower, I'm just going to pray in just a moment, but if you're a Christ follower, you're facing a difficulty right now in your marriage, in your career, in a relationship, in your health, your emotions, maybe your career or finances. God says, stay with the ship. And this is your opportunity right now to just pray and do business with God and ask Him for the courage to stay on the ship and trust Him. Trust that He knows what He's doing. Trust that He's trying to make something beautiful out of your life. So you can pray as I pray in just a moment. And then if you're here today and you've been checking out church or God or been wondering, you know, is this thing for real? Maybe today you finally realize that, you know what? Life is tough. And there are difficulty after difficulty, and you don't have to go it alone. But you have to get on the ship, and you do that by establishing a relationship with God through Jesus Christ and taking His death on the cross and applying it to your past and getting forgiveness and knowing that He has purpose and meaning for your life, even though life's difficult. And you don't have to lose hope because there's eternity waiting for the Christ follower. And if you need to step across that line of faith today and begin that relationship and get on the ship with Jesus Christ, I encourage you to do that as I pray. You can pray right there in your own way, in your own words, in your own seat. Just pray and receive Christ today. Step across the line of faith and begin a journey that even though it's difficult, He will never leave you in the storm. Father, I pray for every person in this room because we all can relate to this. We have so many difficulties that come in life. We just ask you today to show us what we need to do, how we need to respond, and to respond right. Teach us, Lord, not to drift, not to just coast along, and not to discard the things that are important that we're going to need for the journey. And most of all, not to despair, because you are in control, and you are the God of the storm.